John, the fine-tuning of this universe, the so-called anthropic principle, has really become hot. It's disputed among physicists themselves, among theologians, between theologians and philosophers. Everybody is involved now. Why is that the case?
Well, I think where the dispute lies is not actually in the basic science, but in what you make of that, how you incorporate that within a wider view. I mean, it's a fact that carbon, we're carbon-based life, and every atom of carbon in our bodies was once inside a star where people have stardust. Mm-hmm. And that's only possible because the laws of nuclear physics are very delicately balanced to make that a possible process. I don't think there's any question about that. The question is there a significance in that? And basically, there are three different approaches. One simply says, well, we're here because we're here. If there wasn't carbon around, we wouldn't be around. So that's it. That seems to me extraordinarily intellectually lazy when you think of how significant and how remarkable the fine-tuning is. If you don't do it by that, there are two possible strategies. They're both meta-scientific. That's to say, in my view, they go beyond what is well-established scientific understanding and results. One says, well, maybe there are just lots and lots and lots of different universes. And if there are enough of them, and of course there'd have to be a colossal number, then just by chance, one of them is going to be okay for carbon-based life, and that's the one we live in, because we are carbon-based life. In other words, our universe is just, if you like, the winning lottery ticket in a multiversal lottery.
It's the only one we could be observers in, so we think it's unique, and it's really not.
Well, that's right. On the other hand, it seems that's one thing, and people some produce sort of quasi-scientific arguments that say that there should be lots of universes. My old subject of fundamental physics has become immensely speculative, and people are prepared to say, okay, we've got these equations of string theory, we thought they were going to give a unique world, they turn out to give 10 to the 500 different worlds, okay, there must be 10 to the 500 different universes to fit it. That doesn't strike me as being scientific. That seems to me actually extraordinarily rash and prodigal. So that's a metaphysical guess. Of course, there's an alternative metaphysical guess, which is maybe there's only one universe, which is the way it is, because it's not any old world, but is a divine creation, which has been endowed by its creator with precisely the finely tuned laws and circumstances that have enabled it to produce life. And those are theories on the same level. It isn't that the multiverse people are scientific and the religious people are superstitious. They're both going beyond science itself. I buy the second one, of course, because it seems to me that the multiverse idea only does one piece of explanatory work. It explains or explains away the fine-tuning, the apparent fine-tuning of our particular universe. I believe seeing the world as God's creation does a lot of other explanatory works. It explains why the world is marvelously ordered. It explains the very widely testified human experience of encounter with the sacred, and so on. And so it's part of a cumulative case for theism. I believe seeing the world as a creation does many pieces of explanatory work, while the multiverse, I think, only does one. So that's where I put my intellectual money.
Some scientists would say, though, that we're giving up because we really haven't been at quantum physics and uniting quantum physics with relativity long enough to be able to produce a coherent, simple understanding of nature that all of these fine-tuning, so-called fine-tuning concepts will fall out as a result, and we'll find out that the way the world is the way the world had to be. That's the argument.
Well, I'm not at all against exploring. Of course, I'm in fact entirely in favor of exploring how to put quantum theory and relativity together in a consistent way and seeing what results come from that. That's a very worthwhile thing to do. I think it's extremely unlikely that it will produce a unique world. At the moment, as I say, it tends to produce worlds with many, many different possibilities. If it did, that would be the most astonishing anthropic fine-tuning coincidence of all, that putting together these two abstract theories, quantum mechanics and general relativity, produced a world that produces life. That would seem to me the most astonishing piece of fine-tuning that you could imagine. You see, quantum theory and general relativity are not logically necessary theories. They are theories that apply in our world and are very powerful and interesting. But I could think of many, many consistent universes that didn't have either of them in it. So you still have face the question of where does quantum theory come from? Why does general relativity come from? It's pretty clear, I think, that the world wouldn't have a fruitful history without both of those two. You need gravity to clump the world to produce stars and galaxies and things like that. You need quantum theory to have a certain flexibility in process, so it's not just mere mechanism all the time. But these things don't come for free. I mean, to talk about the universe as a free lunch is as misleading as most offers of free lunches turn out to be.
So you see the combination of relativity and quantum theory not just in producing some fine-tuning benefit for us, but enriching the world in some way?
Well, undoubtedly. One of the big scientific insights is that novelty, truly new things, emerge at the edge of chaos. You need a regime in which order and disorder, chance and necessity, if you like, interlace to some degree. If it's all order, it's too rigid, nothing new happens. If it's too haphazard, everything falls apart. And quantum theory, for example, has exactly that mixture between a degree of order and a degree of openness and a variety. And I think that's essential to the fruitfulness of the world.
But you said you could imagine other universes in which those didn't occur.
Yeah, I could imagine a billiard ball universe, Newtonian billiard balls just colliding with each other. There would be nothing inconsistent with that world. But there would be nothing interesting in that world either.
Well, you've now postulated a number of possibilities. Either there will be some ultimate solution in which that, you said how extraordinarily fine-tuned that would be.
Yeah, I don't think that's very likely.
But if that's possible.
It's a possibility.
And then the multiverse.
Yeah.
And then the God. But it seems that no matter what it is, you still have a mechanism for coming back to seeing a creator, almost no matter what the result is.
I wouldn't say, I don't think that physics is going to settle the issue one way or the other. It may give you hints or pointers in some direction, but it's not going to be the decider. I mean, we're not giving up. When we go beyond science to ask meta-scientific questions, we're not giving up. We're in fact taking on. I mean, science is wonderfully successful. I think we have every reason to think the scientifically posable questions will receive scientifically stateable answers. But we have every reason to believe there are many meaningful and necessary questions to ask which are not scientific, and science is just as going to answer. I mean, an atheist, for example, who says that there is no meaning or purpose in the world, someone like Steven Weinberg, who sees the world as essentially futile in the end, that isn't a scientific statement that Steve's making. It's a meta-scientific interpretation of how he sees the universe. And I'm entitled to my meta-scientific interpretation as well, and to argue for it.
Which is somewhat different.
It is somewhat different, of course, yes, absolutely. And these are very deep issues, and it's not altogether surprising that not everybody instantly agrees with one particular point of view.
Why is that? Why did God, in your view, make a world in which people like Steven Weinberg and yourself, two distinguished scientists, two deeply philosophical gentlemen, so disagree?
Well, I think that one of the insights is that of theology is that the infinite presence of the divine has to be veiled from creatures if they are to be free to make a choice about how they understand the world and how they commit their lives. If God just appeared, so to speak, naked and unveiled, that would just overwhelm finite creatures. So God is to some extent necessarily a hidden God, and therefore we don't find the universe full of items marked made by God. God isn't right in the sky, I'm here, watch out. That type of thing. I mean, you might think that it would be handy if God was a little bit more upfront in revealing the divine nature. And of course, all the religious faith traditions believe that God has been. But God has revealed the divine nature, not in general, repeatable things, but in through persons, through unique events. And of course, as a Christian, I believe that God has acted to make God's nature most transparently known to human beings by living the life of a human being in Jesus Christ. So, I mean, God is not wholly hidden, but God is certainly not totally manifest.
And very sincere people who are very thoughtful can disagree.
Yes, absolutely. And it's very important that we respect each other in that respect. When I meet Stephen Weinberg, which I don't do very often, we always talk about God. And not because I force God onto the agenda, but Steve likes to talk about it. And I think that's right. We should pursue these things, even if we can't agree about them.